So here's little Henry again. When he was born in 1491, he was not heir to the crown because he had an older brother named Arthur. It was planned that Henry have a career in the church, become Archbishop of Canterbury or something like that. And he looks the part of the future good son of the church with his rosary. But he was, of course, to become the worst enemy the Roman Catholic Church in England ever had. In 1502, however, Arthur died and Henry did become the heir. He spent a good part of his youth at Eltham Palace in the suburbs of London, the great hall of which, with its hammer-beam roof built in Edward IV's day, still survives, and this is probably the oldest hammer-beam roof in England. It's hard to define a term like hammer-beam roof, but a picture is worth a few hundred words anyway, and this is what one looks like. The hammer beams are the horizontal beams above the brackets, but why they're called hammer beams is anyone's guess. Everyone who saw the young Henry here thought him very promising. He was tall, athletic, smart, a good dancer and musician. Hugh Weldon calls him, in fact, England's most talented king, while Will Durant says he was England's strongest and worst king. And Jasper Ridley, in a recent biography, calls him a blot of grease on the history of the country. These are not mutually inconsistent opinions. He was talented, he was strong, and he was violent. This is a suit of armor made for Henry when he was still young and not as bulky as his mature self became. It was made for a man over 6 feet tall. One of the first things he did after becoming king was marry Catherine of Aragon, who was his brother Arthur's widow. This marriage had been planned by his father, and a dispensation to allow it had been secured from Pope Alexander VI, who would have probably let him marry anyone for the right deal. Henry was 18 and Catherine 23 at the time. This is another suit of armor made for Henry later in life when he'd begun to put on a little weight. This suit is about 6 feet 8 inches high, but some space had to be allowed for head and foot room. Last quarter, we heard about how the French under Louis XII had invaded Italy, and in 1513, acting more or less as the ally of his father-in-law Ferdinand V and the Pope, who were fighting against the French, he invaded France and got his first taste of military action at the Battle of the Spurs, so called because the French are said to have spurred their horses so fast to get away. In any case, it was a victory and helped lead to the withdrawal of Louis XII's army from Italy. To strengthen his army, Henry had also rented a large corps of Austrian mercenaries from the Emperor Maximilian, who sent Henry this helmet as a present after the victory. It's not a very good likeness, but he could have worn it on a Halloween, I guess. Just 2 weeks after the Battle of the Spurs, Henry got word in France that the Scots had also been defeated at Flodden Field by Thomas Howard, the future Duke of Norfolk, who was, incidentally, the grandfather of Catherine Howard. This is the battlefield of Flodden now in northern England. The Scots were the traditional allies of the French, and Henry had not trusted James IV and his weasel Scots, as he called them, to remain quiet while he was out of the country attacking France. So Thomas Howard had been left in the north with a large force, prepared to deal with just the sort of invasion that took place. James himself was killed, where the monument stands on the field.
And here is that monument.
James was, in fact, married to Henry's sister Margaret, but this just illustrates how worthless such marriage alliances could be. James and Margaret are the grandparents of Mary, Queen of Scots, and it's through her grandmother Margaret, then, that Mary will have her own claim by blood to the English throne. Henry's other sister, Mary Tudor, was married to Louis XII, as you may remember from earlier this quarter, as part of the treaty arrangement that followed the Battle of the Spurs. Henry got little but some money and a reputation as a tough guy out of his brief war with France, because Ferdinand and Maximilian both made separate pieces with Louis XII, and Henry himself felt that his first priority had to be getting his own territory at home under control. This is an anonymous portrait of Mary Tudor with her second husband, Charles Brandon, the Duke of Suffolk. You may remember that Henry had promised to let her marry for love the second time if she would marry Louis XII first for the sake of politics, and she lucked out when Louis died a few weeks after their marriage. They are also the grandparents of a queen, the short-lived, short-reigned Lady Jane Grey, about whom we'll hear a little more later. This is a detail from the anonymous painting now at Hampton Court depicting Henry at the Field of the Cloth of Gold, as it was called. This gives you some idea about the state of native English painting at the time, too. This is the height of the Renaissance. It'll still be 200 years before there's a native-born English painter of any genius. After Francis I succeeded Louis XII as King of France, he invited Henry to a big party near Calais in the summer of 1520. This party has been referred to as a kind of combination summit conference and Olympic Games. It was the most splendid such event of the age, in any case. 5,000 English nobles and knights accompanied Henry across the channel, wearing their fields on their backs, as someone has put it. In this photo, you can now see more of the picture. The English won most of the contests, the archery competition, of course, the music competition, and the dog show, but they lost an important wrestling match. At the upper right, you can see the tent of Francis I, and Henry visited him there and challenged him to a wrestling match, which is going on in the painting here, a real first in the history of diplomacy. Francis was also a big fellow, though not as big as Henry, but probably quicker, and he threw the King of England on his back. Henry jumped up in a fury, but was restrained, and it was agreed to call off any further royal horseplay. In this detail, you can see Henry and Francis attending the jousting competition with their wives. By the time of this party, Henry was 29 and Catherine, his wife, was 34. Henry and Catherine had had one daughter, the future Mary Tudor in 1516, but no son. And Henry had already begun to worry about that. One child in 11 years of marriage, and at 34, Catherine didn't have that many childbearing years left. Henry had had at least two illegitimate sons, so he didn't think the problem was with him. On the other hand, Francis's wife, Claude, was just 19 and had already given him two sons, which may have made Henry even sulkier than losing the wrestling match. It's worth noticing that Henry may also have met the 15-year-old Mary and 13-year-old Anne Bullen, the sisters, the daughters of Thomas Bullen, both of whom attended some of the festivities at this time. Here now is an anonymous portrait of Henry's chancellor, Cardinal Wolsey, whose father was a butcher. In fact, most of the people Henry appointed to high positions were commoners. Cranmer's father was a farmer, Cromwell's a brewer. Various reasons are given for this, but the truth is probably that Henry both distrusted the nobility, which had old scores to settle, and appreciated talent, however base in origin. Wolsey, like so many ambitious men before him, chose the church as the road to advancement, and had been the chaplain to Henry VII while still in his 20s. Pope Leo X had made him a cardinal in gratitude for his support of the war effort against the French, and he was appointed chancellor by Henry in 1515. For many years, he was almost the acting ruler of England. "I and the king," he would say, "think so and so," or "I and his majesty will do such and such." This painting is hardly a work of art. It practically hurts the eyes to look at it, and you can see why Holbein was such a success as a portrait painter when he came to England. This is St. James's Palace in London. Henry had lots of fine places to live like this, most of which now no longer survive, including Nonsuch and other similar homes at Richmond and Greenwich. This is now the headquarters of the Yeomen of the Guard, or beefeaters, who wear the distinctive costume supposedly actually designed by Holbein, which you can see on gin bottles. The costume is very similar to that worn by the Yeoman warders at the Tower of London. But as nice as St. James's is, Wolsey had this, Hampton Court Palace just up the Thames from London. The original architect was probably Henry Redman, who was also one of the architects of King's College Chapel at Cambridge, which we saw before the break, but this has little in common with that. Now you see the main entrance at ground level. Wolsey's stock began to fall when he influenced Henry not to support Charles V against the French in the 1520s, and then Charles clobbered the French at Pavia in 1525. Had the English allied themselves with Charles, who was Catherine's nephew, they might have profited from that victory, and Henry was angry about what he considered Wolsey's mistake. The last straw, however, was Wolsey's failure to arrange a divorce from Catherine, a failure which was not unconnected to the other one. After Charles defeated the French, his army occupied Rome and had Pope Clement VII at his mercy, just at the time Henry was pressing Wolsey to press for the divorce. Charles felt he owed Henry no favors, didn't want Henry free to marry a French choice, which is what Wolsey wanted, and didn't want his Aunt Catherine humiliated by the divorce proceedings either. In 1529, a desperate attempt to keep Henry's favor was made by Wolsey when he gave him Hampton Court, but it didn't work. He died less than a year later while Henry was preparing to charge him with treason. We'll see some more of Hampton Court now and hear a piece of dance music of the sort that would have been heard here in Henry's day. This is by the Antwerp composer Telman Susato. Antwerp was sort of the Motown or Nashville of its day, and several of the most important music publishers were headquartered there, and the music they printed circulated all over Europe. This is the main entrance up closer. It's usually described as a Renaissance palace, but it really is so only by date. It at least doesn't look like anything built in Italy at the time. And the crenellations, even though they're really just decorative, make it look more medieval than Renaissance. Brick was a favorite Tudor building material, however, rather than the limestone out of which, for example, Windsor was built, and the elaborate chimneys are also typical of the Tudor style. Now you're looking back through the entrance from inside. This is the so-called Anne Bullen Gateway with the famous clock built by the Nuremberg inventor, Nicholas Kratzer. It tells the time of day of the week and month, phase of the moon, and a high tide time at London Bridge. Here you can see some of those spectacular chimneys, though most have been re-bricked since the 16th century. Here's the kitchen where food was prepared for as many as 290 guests and the staff of 400 servants. It was in many ways a modern residence with indoor plumbing and baths and underground sewers running to the Thames. Here's the great hall with its hammer beam roof. This is Wolsey's office with his motto above the pictures done by anonymous Italians. It reads, Dominus mihi adjutor, or God is my help, but which his enemies rendered, God is my assistant. Thank you.
is a portrait, possibly of Catherine of Aragon, by Michael Citeau.
By 1525, Henry had given up any hope of having a son by her. She was 40 years old. Wolsey, although he opposed the divorce, was ordered by Henry to pursue it nevertheless. As I mentioned, however, the Battle of Pavia and the position of the Pope after that made things difficult. Also, the legal approach taken didn't sit well with Rome. The argument was that Henry should be able to have the marriage annulled because it should never have been permitted in the first place. And this, it was claimed, weighed heavily on the king's conscience. But to go along with this, Clement would have to say that his predecessor, Alexander VI, acting ex cathedra, had done something wrong in granting the original dispensation which allowed the marriage, and that would weigh heavily on the Pope's conscience. As the months and years passed, Henry got more and more angry and Wolsey got more and more nervous. Catherine offered to go into a nunnery if Henry would likewise take his suffering conscience into a monastery, but poverty, chastity, and obedience, as I believe Wilderand says, were not things he found appealing at this point in his life. This is a sketch by Hans Holbein, now of Thomas Bullen, the father of Mary and Anne Bullen. The Bullen family had been wealthy landowners since the days of Thomas's grandfather, who had been Lord Mayor of London, and Thomas had himself achieved a very good match by marrying Elizabeth, the daughter of the Duke of Norfolk. In the 1520s, he'd become a favorite of Henry's, and probably by 1525, his older daughter Mary was Henry's mistress. Some think that even his wife was Henry's mistress, but ironically, I guess, Anne, the younger daughter who was 20 in 1527, the year when Henry proposed marriage to her, probably never was his mistress, at least if one can believe what she wrote in her letters. Hever Castle as it looks today, and it was the Bullen family home. It was bought in 1903 by William Waldorf Astor, who spent a fortune restoring and furnishing it. Not much of the interior is actually 16th century anymore, but it was all done using all the restoration, done using 16th century techniques, tools, and materials. What seem to be village houses at the left are actually guest accommodations built in the Tudor style only 100 years ago. The gardens are considered among the finest in England. As I mentioned earlier, Henry was a talented fellow. He wrote plays, poems, and music of various kinds. And while we take a closer look at Hever, where he spent a lot of time courting Anne Boleyn in the late 1520s, we'll hear a song he may well have written with her in mind. It's called Oh My Heart. Here's Hever Castle at ground level now. Another view. The entrance hall. The so-called Henry VIII bedroom. The inner hall. Part of the garden. Another garden view. And the lake? And this is said to be a copy of an original portrait of Anne by Hans Holbein. In 1529, Wolsey was fired and would have been executed if he hadn't died first. He was replaced as Chancellor by Thomas More, who had been critical of him and also of the church and had been one of the king's most trusted men for many years, acting as lawyer, diplomat, and general counselor. In 1531, Henry declared himself the head of the church in England, adding the phrase, "so far as the law of Christ permits," at the suggestion of William Warham, the Archbishop of Canterbury. More resigned in opposition to this. When Warham conveniently died the next year, Henry appointed Thomas Cranmer, who'd acquired a reputation himself as a harsh critic of the church and supported Henry's claim that he should be able to divorce Catherine, to be the new archbishop. This is another portrait of Anne. In 1533, Henry married her and Cranmer pronounced the marriage to Catherine to have been invalid. I think Henry insisted upon this divorce primarily because he just resented the limits on his power to rule his country the church's opposition to him represented. I think it's not unlikely that even if there had been no problem about the divorce, something else would have come up which would have created the same sort of impasse. Henry was a man who would brook no opposition. He wanted a son, he wanted to marry Anne Boleyn, but what he wanted most of all was to have his own way no matter what he wanted. The future Queen Elizabeth was born in September 1533, 9 months after the wedding. This is Hans Holbein's portrait of Thomas More now. The appointment of More to be chancellor obviously seemed a good idea at the time to Henry, but More, although he was sympathetic like Erasmus to many of the goals of the Reformation, refused to renounce his allegiance to the Pope and his own conscience, and he was every bit as mule-headed as Henry. He was also, at least in his most famous work, Utopia, a communist before communism, and I can't believe that Henry would have made him his chancellor if he'd read that book. What? No hereditary monarchy? What? All men have to have equal wealth? In any case, More resigned when Henry declared himself the head of the church, and then refused to agree to the Act of Succession in 1534, by which Catherine's daughter Mary was proclaimed illegitimate, and Anne's daughter Elizabeth was named heir to the throne. More was then arrested and imprisoned in this cell in the Tower. It's tempting to praise a man for being willing to die for what he believes is right, but of course a lot of people have been willing to die for believing that very wrong or bad things are right. That a man is willing to die for a thing says more about the stubbornness of the man than the virtue of the thing. People who are willing to die for things are first and foremost dangerous people, and that's why Henry had More's head cut off. The execution took place on Tower Hill, where what is called Trinity Square is now located, and where about 75 other accused traitors were executed between the 14th and 18th centuries. Anne Boleyn was to be the first person executed on the grounds of the Tower itself, and probably by the time More was executed, Henry was already getting fed up with her. Here's a portrait of Henry done about 1532 by Hans Holbein, and it's probably the first portrait of the king he painted. Henry and Anne were, as I mentioned, married in January 1533, and she gave birth to Elizabeth, at least a healthy girl, if not a son, 9 months later. Anne was only 26, so there appeared to be plenty of time for a son. Then Anne began to irritate him. She was also stubborn, quick to anger, and when she refused to wear mourning, as Henry had ordered on the death of Catherine, whose mild manner he now missed, in January 1536, that was perhaps the last straw. In fact, Henry had already acknowledged to her that there were other women in his life, and to others that he was looking for a way out of the marriage. She herself was then formally accused of infidelity and imprisoned in the so-called Queen's House, the part of the tower with the back in this view. Regardless of why Henry wanted a divorce from Catherine, his reason for wanting to get rid of Anne was clearly that he just didn't like her anymore. Whether she was really guilty of infidelity is not clear, nor is it clear that Henry even really believed she was guilty himself, although he certainly acted as though he did. This is Anne's bedroom as it looks now in the Queen's House. She was in fact charged with having had affairs with 5 men, including her own brother, which if true argues that she was one of the most foolish women alive. One of the accused lovers confessed, whatever that's worth, but Anne denied to the last any wrongdoing, whatever that's worth. The court that convicted her included her uncle. The court that convicted her lovers, and by implication her, included her own father, whatever that's worth. Her lovers were executed on Tower Hill, but she was beheaded in the bailey of the tower itself,
where this monument is.
She was not mourned by many. Even her own father feared Henry more than he loved her. The day after her execution, the king was betrothed to her maid, Jane Seymour. This is a portrait by Holbein of Queen Jane now. Henry was a man who could marry just about any woman in England he wanted, and what he particularly liked about Jane Seymour is at least not self-evident from her appearance anyway. She is regarded as having been a woman of good moral character. She refused Henry's proposals for things other than marriage, and she is given credit for softening his attitude to his daughter Mary. And in October 1537, she gave birth to a son, the heir, the future Edward VI Henry had wanted for so long. But she then died from postpartum complications just 12 days later. From all the evidence, Henry sincerely mourned her passing and chose her to be buried beside him at Windsor, and he did not marry again for 3 years.
Here's a portrait of Thomas Cranmer, now attributed to Gerhard Flicke, an associate of Holbein's. Cranmer was appointed
Protestant Archbishop of Canterbury. The term Anglican did not come into common use for another century. Henry, in fact, hated Luther, and at least until the 1530s, was essentially a Protestant only insofar as he rejected the Pope's authority in England. Cranmer, Cromwell, and many others close to him, however, were in sympathy with other far-reaching changes being undertaken in Germany and elsewhere, and they tried to push Henry in that direction. And after the king's death, he was to become more of a radical influence under Edward VI. The Book of Common Prayer and the 39 Articles, which are sort of the Anglican equivalent to the Lutheran Augsburg Confession, are Cranmer's primary claims to fame today, and the views expressed in them cost him his life when Catholic Mary Tudor came to power, as we'll see next week. Here's Thomas Cromwell by Holbein. Henry appointed him to be vice-regent for ecclesiastical affairs, and he was Henry's primary agent in the seizure of monastic property that began in 1536. This was obviously a dangerous step to take, and it brought about serious resistance, especially in the north, which remained largely Catholic and loyal to Rome. Henry pursued the policy relentlessly, however, and the selling of confiscated abbeys did bring a lot of money into the treasury. Cromwell himself bought half a dozen, which helped make his more famous distant relative, Oliver Cromwell, a wealthy man in the next century. This is a portrait of Hans Holbein himself now. He was born probably in 1497 into a family of painters in Augsburg, and became the last great German painter of the Reformation era. Among his first important works were the woodcuts he did for Erasmus's book In Praise of Folly we heard about earlier, and his first great portrait is often said to be the one of Erasmus we also saw last time. His Meyer altarpiece, done for the Catholic former mayor of Basel, was painted in 1526, shortly before his first trip to England. Meyer had been impeached for refusing to go along with Basel's turn to Protestantism, and in part may have commissioned this as an affirmation of his faith despite this. Also, however, his two sons who are pictured here had died earlier in the year, and so the painting may have been primarily in their honor. His first and second wives are both depicted at the right, along with his daughter. And this is a detail from the picture showing the portraits of the deceased and current wives. And it was, of course, as a painter of portraits that he was eventually to become the toast of England. With encouragement and a letter of introduction to Thomas More, he left for England soon after he painted this picture, and was well received by More and got several important commissions, though no notice from the king. He had committed himself to return to Basel in 2 years, and he had also left his family there, so back he went, probably planning to return to England as soon as he could. In 1532, he did return to England after painting this picture of his wife and children who would never see him again. Kenneth Clark says this displays the intimate feeling of family life, but it looks to me like he's just told them he's never coming back. Sadness is not an emotion one usually sees in portrait subjects. Sad people don't usually want their pictures painted, and I doubt this is a picture for which the subjects really posed. This is a portrait of the German businessman Georg Giese, and it's the first he painted Holbein after his return to England in 1532, and some think it was used as a sort of advertisement to display his amazing technique.
Apart from the picture of his wife and children, most of Holbein's portrait subjects are not displaying any very overt emotion, but with some of them, at least, there is a kind of aggressive intensity, if not profundity, in the expression.
Here's a detail from the picture. While we see some more portraits by Holbein, we're going to hear another song written by Henry VIII himself. This one is called Pastime with Good Company.
Pastime with good company.
This is the third Duke of Norfolk, the victor at Flodden, and the uncle of Anne Boleyn, who voted to condemn her to death.
So God be pleased, so live will I.
This is a sketch by Holbein of his son, the Earl of Surrey, who was to be executed by Henry for treason, and the Duke himself only escaped execution as an accessory because of the death of the king himself. Surrey was himself a poet, as was this fellow, Robert Southwell, by Holbein. Simon George was not, as far as I know, a poet, but he looks like one. This is the poet Thomas Wyatt by Holbein. Wyatt was originally on the short list of those accused of adultery with Anne, but he was found innocent. His son was to be executed for attempting to overthrow Mary Tudor. This is Charles de Saulier, who was an ambassador at Henry's court. This is Anton the Good, Duke of Lorraine. These are all by Holbein now. This is Nicholas Kratzer, the inventor from Nuremberg, who made the clock for Hampton Court. He was also the tutor of Thomas More's children, and while in Nuremberg, he'd been a good friend of Albrecht Dürer's. The Ambassadors in the London National Gallery is the picture that is usually considered Holbein's finest masterpiece, and we'll begin with it next time and go on to hear more about Henry Francis I, Queen Elizabeth and Shakespeare.
But mirth and play is best of all. Company with honesty is virtue, vices do flee. Company is good and thin, but every man hath his free will. The best ends you, the worst ends true. My mind shall be virtue.